to give the first talk of the day. And if you will share your screen, I don't know the title. Yeah, an exactly solvable model for fractional quantum Hall effect. So the floor is yours.
Okay, so I want to make sure you can see the cursor.
Yes, yes. Okay. Perfect. Yeah.
All right, so it's it would have been nicer to be at Stony Brook, my alma mater, physically, but you know, life is what it is. So at least I'm there virtually. That's also nice. So I would like to tell you about a recent work by Srijit and Abhishek Anand, who are both at Indian Institute for Science Education and Research, Pune in India. This work that deals with an exactly solvable model for the fractional quantum Hall effect. Okay, so exact models play an important role in the developments of many fields, and that's certainly true for fractional quantum Hall effect as well. So a conventional approach has been to consider electrons confined to the lowest lambda level, which is the appropriate thing to do in the limit of extremely high magnetic fields. And the whole field of exact models started with a work by Duncan Haldane, who noted that in Laughlin's wave function, pairs have a minimum angular momentum equal to 3. I would like to stop share and share it again because I keep getting all these messages which are distracting. So just give me a second. Okay, that doesn't change anything. Okay, we'll just continue with this. So Duncan then constructed a model that imposes a penalty on pairs with angular momentum less than 3. So for fully polarized electrons, which is what I would be considering in this talk, this means imposing a penalty for pairs with angular momentum equal to 1. In this case, Laughlin's wave function is the exact and unique zero energy ground state for this interaction. And furthermore, for filling factors less than 1, one can identify all of the zero energy modes of this interaction. Such interactions have been constructed for other wave functions as well. So for the Mohr-Reed Fafian wave function, there is an interaction that was written by Greiter, Wen, Wilczek. An explicit real space form for these interactions can be constructed by taking appropriate derivatives of the delta function following the approach by Trugman and Kivelson. Accurate wave functions also exist for fractions of the form n over 2n plus minus 1. They are written here. Here, PLLL is the lowest lambda level projection operator. Phi n is the wave function of n filled lambda levels. And this is the usual Jastrow factor. These wave functions, once you project them into the lowest lambda level, they are extremely complicated. They don't have the simple form that we have for Laughlin's wave function. But nonetheless, they're extremely accurate. So one could ask whether these can be obtained as exact solutions of some parent model Hamiltonian. So we looked at this problem in great detail. We looked at clustering properties of 2, 3, and 4 particles, but at least up to 4 particle interactions, we have failed to find an truncated pseudo-potential model that would produce these wave functions as exact ground states. One can ignore the lowest lambda level projection because then the remaining wave function at least has a simpler form for filling factor 2/5, for which the unprojected wave function has this form. One can actually write a model interaction, that's the Trugman-Kivelson interaction, which produces the 2/5 state as the exact ground state, provided one keeps only the lowest two lambda levels and assumes them to be degenerate. So this seems like a funny model, but this kind of situation can actually occur in graphene, in bilayer graphene. But anyway, that's a separate issue. In this case, we can start with a model where the two lowest lambda levels were degenerate, and then introduce a splitting between them, and one can show, at least numerically, that that this ground state adiabatically evolves into the lowest lambda level ground state as the splitting between the two lambda levels is increased from zero to infinity. As an aside, if we keep three lambda levels, then that produces the so-called 2-to-1 state. So this is not the Halperin 2-to-1 state, but it's a Parton 2-to-1 state as the exact and unique ground state at filling factor 1/2. So for all of these models, one thing that they share is that only the zero energy modes are known, and also each model produces only one fractional quantum Hall state. These are various papers that are listed here for completeness that have looked at various exactly solvable models. Okay, so we are going to take a slightly different approach. So just as a background, let me state that there are two routes to strong correlations. So if we go to pre-fractional quantum Hall effect days, the phrase strongly correlated systems would refer to systems for which the interaction energy dominates over the kinetic energy. In fractional Hall effect, we actually consider the other limit where the kinetic energy is infinitely large compared to the interaction energy. Here, strong correlations arise because the lambda levels are flat. So once we restrict electrons to be in the lowest lambda level, the physics is completely determined by interaction. So what I'm going to show today is that it's actually interesting to come back to the previous way of thinking about a strongly correlated system. So the approach would be the following. This is the standard Hamiltonian for electrons interacting with some interaction in two dimensions. We will consider the limit where the interaction energy is infinitely large compared to the kinetic energy. We won't work with the Coulomb interaction. We will actually choose some truncated Haldane pseudo-potential interaction, and I'm going to tell you in a couple of slides what that interaction is. The choice of which pseudo-potentials are taken to be non-zero will be motivated by the composite fermion physics, as we will see. In the limit when the interaction energy is sent to infinity, only states with zero interaction energy will survive. So the role of interaction in this model will be to impose a non-trivial constraint on the allowed space of many particle wave functions. Within this constrained Hilbert space, the Hamiltonian consists only of the kinetic energy. I will show that for our choice of the pseudo-potential model, we will be able to identify all eigenstates that have a finite energy, and here finite means non-infinite energy at arbitrary filling factors below 1/2. We will see that the spectrum at any filling factor nu has an exact 1-to-1 correspondence with the spectrum of non-interacting fermions at filling factor nu star, where nu and nu star are related by the standard equation. And in particular, this model will exhibit fractional quantum Hall effect at these sequences of fractions, with a gap equal to the cyclotron energy. I should say as a caveat that this model is not meant to give a realistic account of lambda level mixing. But we will give arguments to show that the fractional quantum Hall states of this model lie in the same universality class as the fractional quantum Hall states of the lowest standard level Coulomb interaction. Okay, so let's construct the model Hamiltonian. So the inspiration is the composite fermion physics, where we obtain fractional quantum Hall states from integer quantum Hall states by multiplying by this Jastrow factor, where the Jastrow factor converts electrons into composite fermions by vortex attachment, but it also at the same time increases the relative angular momentum, which I will call m, of each pair by 2p. The resulting state is not an eigenstate of the kinetic energy, however, because the Jastrow factor causes inter-lambda level transitions. So for example, if you construct a two-particle state with some definite relative angular momentum in the second lambda level, and you multiply by this Jastrow factor, it will produce a component that involves the lowest lambda level. So one of the key things we'll do is to consider an interaction that conserves the lambda level index. So just to be more specific, let's consider the disk geometry where the smallest angular momentum in the nth lambda level is minus n. Let's consider a pair of electrons, one in the nth lambda level and the other in the n prime lambda level. If n and n prime are different, then the smallest relative angular momentum this pair can have is simply minus n minus n prime. If they're in the same lambda level, then we have to add one to make sure that we take care of the Pauli principle. Let us now increase the angular momentum of each pair by 2p units while preserving the lambda level index. So the state that results from this process is such that the minimum relative angular momentum of each pair is given by this quantity. So it's same as before with an addition of 2p. In other words, in the resulting state, pairs with relative angular momenta m less than this number are absent. So now we'll go ahead and construct an interaction that imposes this constraint. This interaction is shown here. Here n, n primed m means it refers to a state with a particle in n, nth lambda level, a particle in n prime lambda level with relative angular momentum m. And these coefficients, v's, are a generalization of the Haldane pseudo potentials to include inter as well as intra lambda level pairs with relative angular momentum m. Now, notice one thing here, which is that this interaction preserves the lambda level index. So the incoming particles and outgoing particles have the same lambda level index. So as a result, it conserves the number of electrons n sub n in each lambda level, and this interaction commutes with the kinetic energy. So we are going to label each eigenstate by the total angular momentum and a set of numbers which tell us how many particles there are in each lambda level. In the limit where the pseudo potentials go to infinity relative to cyclotron energy, all states with non-zero interaction energy are projected out. We are going to refer to the collection of states that are eigenstates of the kinetic energy and that have zero interaction energy as V infinity space. As I mentioned earlier, in the previous approaches, the limit that was considered was where the cyclotron energy goes to infinity. In this case, the Hilbert space was constrained to the lowest lambda level. This constraint could be implemented at the single particle level. The constraint that we are talking about in our work, the V infinity space, cannot be defined at the single particle level. It's a many-body constraint on the space of allowed wave functions. And as I mentioned earlier, within the constrained Hilbert space, the only term that remains in the Hamiltonian is the kinetic energy. So let's go ahead and construct V infinity states. So we are going to begin with phi nu star, which denote the complete set of kinetic energy eigenstates of non-interacting electrons at filling factor nu star. Let's now multiply by this Jastrow factor. This does the job of increasing the relative angular momentum of each pair by 2p, but it does not conserve the lambda level index. So we are instead going to consider this wave function, where instead of the Jastrow factor, we have a generalized Jastrow operator, where capital Z represents the guiding center coordinate. Now, this wave function belongs to the V infinity space, which can be seen from the following observations. First of all, the guiding center coordinate does not cause inter-lambda level scattering because it commutes with the kinetic energy. Secondly, multiplication by capital G increases the relative angular momentum by 1 unit. And finally, multiplication by Zj minus Zk commutes with the center of mass coordinate and its angular momentum, and therefore it raises the relative angular momentum by 1 unit. So therefore, this factor raises the relative angular momentum of each pair by 2p units while also conserving the kinetic energy. One can show that this state has a filling factor given by nu star divided by 2p nu star plus 1, the standard relation that we have from composite fermion theory. As is obvious, these wave functions are different from the standard composite fermion wave functions. These are in general very complex because this is a product of lots and lots of derivatives, but in principle, these are well-defined. Now, you might ask, are there other wave functions for V infinity states? So we have tried to construct other wave functions but failed. You could also ask whether these wave functions are linearly independent. In other words, if you start with different integer Hall wave functions, do you get linearly independent fractional quantum Hall wave functions? Again, we don't have a proof, but the wave functions are so complicated that it's kind of plausible to expect that they would all be different. Nonetheless, we make the conjecture that these states provide a complete basis for V infinity space. And I'm going to show you numerical results that provide, in our opinion, a compelling case for this conjecture. So if this conjecture is true, that would imply that the spectrum of our model of strongly correlated electrons at nu is identical to that of non-interacting electrons at nu star. And in particular, this model would then produce fractional quantum Hall effect at these sequences in complete analogy to integer quantum Hall effect. Okay, so let's test the conjecture. For this purpose, it's much more elegant to use Haldane's spherical geometry. So here we have n electrons on the surface of a sphere subjected to a total magnetic field given by 2q times flux quanta. 2q is an integer. This system will be denoted by n, 2q. Our model, by analogy to composite fermion theory, relates the interacting system at n2q to the non-interacting system at n2q star, where 2q star is the effective flux, q star being given by this expression. Now, in the following, I will specialize to 2p equals 2. So these are composite fermions carrying 2 flux quanta. The Hamiltonian that I had written earlier, or the interaction that I had written earlier, can be translated into the spherical geometry in this fashion. Here, what we have used is that the relative angular momentum m in the disk geometry corresponds to an angular momentum of 2q minus m in the spherical geometry. So just to give you an idea, we have performed exact diagonalization for lots and lots of different systems, which are listed here. Here we have kept the lowest 3 lambda levels. The full Hilbert space is extremely large. It's prohibitively large, but one can still perform calculations because we can diagonalize in each N0, N1, N2 sector separately, where N0, N1, N2 are the number of electrons in the three lowest lambda levels. We have tested close to 200 systems and found that in each case, the spectrum of V infinity states matches exactly that of non-interacting electrons at the corresponding effective flux. So therefore, we are confident that we have the exact wave functions and energies of all states in the V infinity space, including incompressible states, quasi-particles, quasi-holes, neutral excitations, but in fact, all of them, you know, multiple quasi-particles, multiple quasi-holes, multiple excitations, we have the complete solution for this. So just to give you a show this result pictorially, here, these are the spectra of several systems calculated. So we take a 2Q, which is shown here, number of particles is shown here, and then this is exact diagonalization, keeping the lowest three lambda levels. In this calculation, we have not set the pseudo potentials to infinity, but we have set pseudo potentials to 20 times h bar omega c. And therefore, this spectrum consists of states which have zero interaction energy, which are shown in red, as well as states which have non-zero interaction energy, which are shown in gray. When we take the limit of pseudo potentials going to infinity, all of the gray states will go all the way to infinity. In all of these cases, if you just look at the red states, these look exactly like the spectrum that we would have for non-interacting electrons at the effective flux 2k star. So just to emphasize this, these spectra involve filling factors 1/3, 2/5, 3/7, but also quasi-holes, quasi-particles, etc. at these filling factors. These are some numbers. So this gives a number of independent states for several systems where N0, N1, N2 are shown in this column, 2Q are shown in other columns. And the number of independent states in each case is exactly equal to the number of independent states of non-interacting particles at the corresponding effective flux. Okay. So the intermediate conclusion is that we have been able to construct a model of strongly interacting electrons, which is exactly solvable in the sense that we know all the V infinity eigenstates and eigenenergies. This model exhibits fractional Hall effect at these sequences in complete analogy to integer quantum Hall effect. I should stress that the model is finally balanced, in the sense that if we take some of the active Haldane pseudo potentials and set them equal to zero, or if we take some of the zero pseudo potentials and turn them on, this exact correspondence breaks down. Okay, let's now come to the question, what does this model have to do, if anything, with the fractional Hall effect of Coulomb electrons in the lowest lambda level? Let me point out that the lowest lambda level constraint had seemed very natural in the beginning because the quantity kappa, which is the ratio of the Coulomb energy to the cyclotron energy, was very small. But now we know that fractional Hall effect actually survives to fairly large values of kappa. So in hole type samples or in zinc oxide, fractional quantum Hall effect is seen for kappa values of 5 to 6. And in aluminum arsenide systems, one can see 1/3 state even for kappa as large as 15. So the limit of large interaction energy is not entirely unphysical, but nonetheless, our model is it's not meant to provide a quantitative account of the physics of lambda level mixing. So parenthetically, we have a different method that's called fixed phase diffusion Monte Carlo approach, starting from the lowest lambda level projected wave functions, which provides a fairly decent account of the physics of lambda level mixing. One can nonetheless ask, does our model provide a topologically faithful account of fractional quantum Hall effect of Coulomb electrons in the lowest lambda level? So let me first point out that the solutions share many topological properties with the standard lowest lambda level fractional quantum Hall states. So here is a list of them. So first of all, we get the standard sequences by analogy to integer quantum Hall effect. The counting of bulk and edge excitations at fractions of the form n over 2n plus 1 is identical to the counting at the corresponding integer Hall states, integer Hall state rather. In particular,
you have only 5 minutes, 4 minutes actually. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Thank you. In particular, the edge is described in terms of n chiral edge modes. This is something I cannot make very rigorous, but at least in a moral sense, the wave functions of this model are topologically similar to the standard wave functions of composite fermions. So we have integer Hall states times a Jastrow factor. In this case, instead of the Jastrow factor, we have a generalized Jastrow operator, but nonetheless, the structure of the wave functions is very similar. The fractional Hall states occur at the same shift as the fractional Hall states of the lowest lambda level Coulomb model. The one-to-one correspondence with the integer quantum Hall effect implies that the excitations obey abelian rate statistics, because in integer Hall effect, if you fix the positions of the excitations, then the wave function is fully fixed. And that property is inherited by the solutions of our model. The quasi-particles and quasi-holes have charge 1 over 2n plus 1. So this can be seen in many ways by following Laughlin's argument, by simple counting, and also by an explicit calculation. So here is a calculation of the charge of a quasi-particle at 1/3, quasi-particle at 2/5, and quasi-hole at 2/5. So this is the accumulated charge, and these saturate to 1/3, 1/5, and 1/5. Okay. To really confirm that the two phases are in the same, they describe the same topology, one would like to show that there is an adiabatic continuity. So the question is there a path in the parameter space from our model to the lowest lambda level Coulomb model on which the gap remains non-zero? This is far from obvious because the states of our model have a very high kinetic energy. In particular, if we just simply increase h bar omega c, the eigenenergies move relative to one another. The eigen functions do not change because the Hamiltonian commutes with the kinetic energy. But as eigenenergies move relative to one another, there will be lots and lots of level crossings in the ground state as h bar omega c becomes larger than the interaction energy, with some exceptions. You know, the 1/3 state is an exception, but in general, there'll be lots of level crossings. One might think that if we take a more generic interaction, then the level crossings would turn into anti-crossings. Nonetheless, the parameter space is very large. It consists of cyclotron energy, various pseudo potentials. So there is a lot of different possible paths. But here are calculations along one possible path for the ground states and the quasi-particle and quasi-hole excitations at filling factor 1/3 and 2/5. So since I don't have much time, let me quickly describe to you what the path is. So we start on the left with a model where all of the Haldane pseudopotentials have been, all of the non-zero Haldane pseudopotentials have been set equal to 1 in Coulomb units, and the cyclotron energy is set to be 20 times smaller The energies in all of these panels are measured relative to the ground state. So green is the ground state and the orange line is the first excited state. Here, first we go from Haldane, from our model to the Coulomb model, keeping the cyclotron energy fixed. Then from here to here, we increase the cyclotron energy from a value which was 0.05 to a value that is 2. So on the right-hand side, we basically are in the limit of lowest lambda level Coulomb interaction. And in all of these cases, you can see that even though the energy gap changes in some funny way, but the gap remains robustly non-zero over the entire path.
Janendra, you are already over time, a minute. Can you wrap up soon?
Okay, let me do that. So let me come to the conclusion slide. So we have constructed a model of strongly interacting electrons, which is exactly solvable. This model shares several topological features of the lowest lambda level fractional Hall effect. And we have found that our model states are adiabatically connected to the lowest lambda level fractional quantum Hall effect for systems that are accessible to numerical studies. This suggests, but does not rigorously prove, that our states may be adiabatically continued to lowest lambda level states in the thermodynamic limit. Okay, with this, I will stop. Sorry for taking extra time, but.
Thank you so much for the wonderful talk. I will just take one question.